Hi, this is Bill, and in chapter 13 in the textbook, I talked about driving a stepper motor using a shift register. We're going to need this information in order to do the LabVIEW assignment, which would be to use the LabVIEW DAC board to produce digital outputs that will enable us to spin a stepper motor. A stepper motor makes its rotation in steps instead of smooth continuous motion as with conventional motors. Typical stepping angles are 15 or 7.5 degrees per step or even less. This will require 24 or 48 steps respectively to complete one revolution. A stepping action is controlled by digital signals that energize magnetic coils within the motor. So in figure 1324, I'm showing the rotor, which actually has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 teeth, and then 8 different magnets. So as you are energizing coil 1, it's lined up this way. As soon as you energize coil 2, this tab aligns with that magnetic coil. And then when you energize number 3, then this one. And so what we're going to do is take several steps as we energize coil 1, then 2, then 3, then 4, and then repeat 1, then 2, then 3, then 4. And the diagram on the left shows that in a little bit more detail. So to go clockwise, we energize 1, then 2, then 3, then 4. And then to go counterclockwise, you do 4, then 3, then 2, then 1. Now our particular stepper motor is an active low drive stepper motor, so we're going to energize it with a low, high, 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 and then a high, low, high, high, and so on, just to complement. So back in figure 13.6, I show a ring shift counter, which is basically just a shift counter. It's going to shift to the right, and I take the last bit and recirculate it back into the front. So during the first clock period, I have a high, low, low, low. The next clock period is a low, high, low, low, and so on. You'll see the one rotates to the higher position each time, and then when it hits the Q3, it goes back to the one and starts over again. This is going to be a for loop in our LabVIEW program with four entries in it. Once it comes out, we're going to come back in again with the same four entries over and over again. Now the other thing is when you look at these numbers, this would be the number 1, and when you go to the next bit, this is the number 2, the next bit is the bit 4, and the next bit is the bit 8. And basically what we're doing is multiplying by 2. If you take 1 times 2, you get 2, and then you take that value, 2 times 2 is 4, and you take that value, 4 times 2 is 8. So we're going to use the multiplication scheme to move that bit to the right, and we'll use a division scheme to go backwards. Okay, so we'll start out by doing a for loop. So in the functions palette, programming structures, for loop, and I'll drag this down here. And we're going to add 4, so I'll right click, say create constant. We'll put the number 4 in there, and then inside let's do the DAC assistant. Right click, that would be express, and we're going to be doing let's do that again, right click, express, output, DAC assistant, and I'm off the screen here. Let's see, so to try to stay on the screen, I will go express, output, DAC assistant, drop it there, and we're going to generate signals, digital output, a whole port at a time. We'll use port. Now I'm using the USB interface because I'm actually doing this at home and I don't have the hardware that we have. We're using the board that's implanted inside a PC, so the USB 6000A is a real nice one to use. Port 0, and the one that's integrated inside the PC in lab is will be done just the same way. So I say finish, and it will define this. I'm going to divert all the outputs so that we'll be driving active low. And on the bottom right corner of the screen, it's off your screen, but I have to press OK at this point. And it develops the VI for us, and it creates a data input. Now, when I drive this data input with a 1, 2, 4, 8, it will be appearing on the screw terminals of our DAC board. Now, what we need to do is set up a shift register. So if you right click on the for loop and say replace and I'm beginning to see it matters where you click. If you click here, you don't get the choice, but if you click over here, you do get the choice for a shift register. Add shift register. And it's kind of off your screen, but it's on right there. Add shift, and you see these arrows, the downward arrow and the upward arrow. Now what we're going to do is input an initial constant into the left side of the shift register. Now I wish I could right click here and say create constant, but it doesn't let me do that. I haven't figured out why. So what we got to do is find a constant. One way is to grab this constant, just highlight a little and say control copy and then control paste, control V, and I've got a constant that way. And I could type in the number 1 and I'll drag this over a little closer and tie it in to the input. Now this constant is going to come in and I want it to go through the loop and become a 2, then a 4, then an 8. So I'm going to multiply. So I have to do numeric multiply and I'm going to multiply by 2. So I'll put a 2 here and I'll take that number and multiply by 2 and take the result and send it on out. Now, as it's being sent out, it's going to go up through and you can run the light bulb here and it'll show you the number 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4 going around. And while it's going out, I want to send it into the DAC assistant. Now, the DAC assistant, since we're dealing with a full port, needs an array. So we have to right click and say create array. So here's an array, build array, and we'll drop that right here. And I'll connect this side into the scalar, oops, the scalar value. And this side will come out as an array. And you see the difference in the thickness. So see if this is going to work. Let's press the highlight execution and run it through one time. The one comes through, there's a one, gets multiplied by 2, goes on out, comes over on the other side as a 2. The 2 gets multiplied by 2, goes over the other side, comes back in as a 4. Goes multiplied by the 8 comes around, comes in as an 8. We want to be done at this point. It'll actually do the 16 at the multiplication point, but it will never get sent into the DAC assistant. Also, if we want to see this array, if I go to this line, right click and say create an indicator, it'll actually put an array element. Let's put this, let's put it down here anyway. And we'll actually get to see this array on the front panel. Drag that back over there. Okay. And if you look at the front panel, you'll actually see the array and we'll see this count up. And I want to right click on this and say display format. And let's make this binary. And I just noticed that all these lines are orange. And if you right click on this constant and look at the representation, you'll see that it's double, which is a floating point representation instead of just a straight integer. Let's change this to i8, which will be a single byte because that's what we want to send out anyway. And when you change just this, it changes everything to integers all the way through. So this is an 8-bit integer. These will all be 8-bit integers. This is an array of 8-bit integers. Okay, so now with the highlight execution on, if I run this, we can see the value that's going to be sent out of the DAC when it'll be right here, 1, and then a 2, and then a 4, and then an 8. Now, if I change this to binary, I'll stop this for a second. I think I can go down here, right click, representation, display format. Maybe that's it. Yeah, display format, and I can choose binary Okay, and now when I run it, we'll see there's a number 4. So it's a 1 in binary, and then you'll see a 2 in binary. Then you'll see the 4 in binary, and then the 8 in binary, and that should be it. That's it. Okay, now we're only going to do 1, 2, 4, 8 one time. So let's put a big loop around this. So we'll say structures and do a while loop around the entire thing. So once it's done, it'll do it again and again and again until we say stop. So we need to right click on the stop button and create a control, which will appear down here as a stop button. And let's get rid of this execution. And to slow this thing down, let's put a timer on the inside. So I'll right click and I'll say timing, and let's grab a timer and make this about a half second. Create a constant for that of a half second, 500 milliseconds. And we took the light bulb off. Now when we run this, we should see this count half second intervals. 1, 2, 4, 8, 1, 2, 4, 8, and it continues to go until I press the stop button and it stops it. It actually stops it after it completes the cycle of 4. So again, so it's going around. So I have to wait, I hit stop, and it'll stop once it's gone all the way around, and there it stopped. So your task is to come up with a variable speed for the stepper motor and also a reversing stepping motor. We want to go in the opposite direction. So like I said, instead of multiplying by 2 to get the shift to the right, dividing by 2, if you take the number 8 divided by 2, you get a 4. That in a sense is going the opposite way. And the DAC assistant, of course, is inverting all our outputs because our stepper is an active low drive stepper motor. Okay, so I hope this was enough information to get you started on driving a stepper motor and using the digital outputs of LabVIEW. That's it.